I've missed you. I've missed you. I'm so glad to be here in your midst this evening, though. Hallelujah. I just don't know what to say about this world. But for this time, after we came in the door and the door was closed, this is a different atmosphere in here. The presence of the Lord is here. I brought him in with me because God lives in me through the Holy Spirit and he lives in you. So we are just going to feast and just enjoy the presence of God together. Amen? Amen. But I wanted to, this was going to be my evening of encouragement. So I wasn't going to do ventriloquism, play the violin, dance, do the hokey pokey and turn himself around. I just really feel like singing some good old down-home hymns. Is that all right with you? Yeah. Hallelujah. And the first one that I'm going to do is Great is Thy Faithfulness. And you know, there is so much going on. I can't even wrap my head around it. Last year when the pandemic first started, every day I woke up, I said, this is surreal. Is this really real? This is surreal. I kept saying surreal. Now it's like a part of life. But every day there's a new development. But let me tell you, Jesus Christ is the same today, yesterday, and forever. And the promises that God made is for now. And I'm going to sing, Great is Thy Faithfulness, because it is not up to the doctor. It's not up to the president. Those things are all right. But you know, it is God, my Father God, who is going to handle everything for me. I don't know about you, but my Father is going to take care of me. And my big brother is a shepherd, and he's going to take care of me. And God promised in his word, he said, great is his faithfulness to us. So I pray this song ministers to your heart, because I'm going to take it for myself, and I may not even realize that y'all in the room. Thank you, Eugene. Hallelujah. Thank you, God, for your faithfulness. Thank you. Thank you that you're always there. Hallelujah.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning.
Oh,
faithfulness. God is faithful, isn't he? He will never leave us. He will never forsake us. He is right there. He's right there. Hallelujah. Hide that in your heart this evening. When you go home and you turn on the news at 11 o'clock and it looks scary and all the threatening and the soldiers with their guns and everybody's, ooh, great is thy faithfulness. Remember that song. Just sing it to yourself. Great is thy faithfulness. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. You know, life is hard. It is. It is difficult. The things that I'm seeing right now, the pandemic, all this stuff, it is hard. You know, you can't lie and say, oh, I don't care about that stuff. Oh, please. I care about it a lot. I have family. We've lost friends and family. You know, it's real. Yeah. All the politics stuff going on and the racial things going on, it's like, you don't even want to leave out the house. You want to just get underneath the bed. But I'm going to tell you what God told me when I told him, what's going on? That's what I told him. I was like, what's going on? Because God always tells me what's going on. And he hasn't been saying anything lately until last week he did. And he said, when I said, what's going on? I said, what do you want me to do? The churches are closed, basically. You can't witness. People got masks on. You don't. Nobody wants to take anything out of your hand. I said, what do you want me to do? And he said, worship me. Spend time loving me, praising me, worshiping me, just being with me. I want to be with you. And you got plenty of time to do that. And I said, I sure do, Lord, sure do. But, you know, this thing is so real that none of us, life is not promised to any of us. And, you know, I'm just going to say it. Let's put it out there. Life is not promised to any of us. We can be here today, gone tomorrow. We have a pandemic going on. We got people shooting and acting crazy. Anything could happen. And so it caused me to start thinking about heaven. Now, you know, I know about heaven and everything, but I said, I'm just going to be thinking about what's going on up there because that will give me some peace. So I went out and I ordered this book on Amazon, and it's called Imagine Heaven. And it's a doctor. He said he spent 30 years writing this about people's near-death experiences. Now, you know, it's a little controversial, and some people go, oh, you shouldn't believe that. But I had a vision one day that was similar to this, and so as I'm reading this in here of people's experiences, I had a similar experience, so I kind of believe it. And it just gave me comfort to know that most of the people said they felt a lot of love. Some people said they saw Jesus, and I said, you know, that's really a good thought. But even more so than this, this is going to be about my song that I'm singing next called It Is Well With My Soul. And as I was thinking about heaven and thinking about all the things that's going on earth, thinking about, oh, you could get the virus, you could not get the virus, you know, you could get shot, you could not get shot, I was like, there is one thing I am certain of, that it is well with my soul. Amen. And when I thought about what Jesus did to make me be able to sing this song with such passion and conviction, that it is well with my soul, that no matter what goes on in this world, the word of God says, don't be scared of what man can do to you. Be scared what God can do to you. But I know that I am saved. I know where my soul is going. And to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. So I'm not afraid. I'm not afraid. It is well with my soul. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for that reassurance. Oh, hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
Peace like a river, a Thank you, Jesus. It is well.
Hallelujah. Glory to God.
With my soul.
Television, by the news, by all the things that are going on. I'm controlled by my Father God. I belong to heaven. I belong to Him. I'm not a part of this world. I'm an alien here. This is not my home. I trust God. I trust God. I trust God. I love Him and I thank God for His love for me. Oh, hallelujah. If you're watching on Facebook, just know that God is on the throne. He's the Almighty. Don't question His ways. Just put all of your trust in Him no matter what goes on. If it is well with your soul, if it's well with you and God, then you are good, okay. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Put your mind on Christ. Put your mind on the Lord. Oh, hallelujah. God is good. Glory to God. God is good. Oh, hallelujah. Glory, glory, glory. Hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
Praise the Lord. Moving right slow. Praise you, Lord. Praise you, Lord. Good evening, everyone. I hope it's well with your soul. I truly hope it's well with your soul. Praise God. There you all are. I can see you now. That's very good. That's very good. Yeah, Tanya was saying there's so much going on that if you weren't anchored in the Lord, you'd be swept away, wouldn't you? Yep. Right? You'd be swept away. And that's what we're going to be discussing this evening, a sure anchor for your soul. I'm bowing a moment for prayer. Our Father and our God, I just ask right now, Lord, that hearts are prepared to receive your word. I know that they are, both here and on Facebook. Father, let your word penetrate deeply and change lives. Mine included. Father, I ask this in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. You know, in order for us to see things differently than what's going on, in order for us to kind of see things becoming better, we have to be willing to be the change. Amen? And I didn't hear the amen at first. You know, I think maybe I said, who? I know there ain't be no change. Yes, we have to be the change. we watch the news, we read the newspaper. That's not the way it's supposed to be. You don't like it? Change it. If you don't like it, change it. We rather sit back and moan and groan about what's going on instead of being that change agent out there. And let me tell you something. The Lord has endowed each and every one of us in this room that know Jesus as our Lord and Savior. He has endowed each and every one of us with the power to be that change agent. Now, you might be saying, but I don't know what he wants me to do. And I think that for those of you that listen to me often enough, you know that that's not something that I like to hear. Because a saint of God who's in the Word knows the minimal, the bare minimum of what the Lord wants you to do. He wants you to be an ambassador of Christ. And he wants you to operate in your ministry of reconciliation. Those two things are written clearly in the Bible. So if you don't know anything else, do that. Do that. And you'll be amazed at how he will broaden your horizon. I know what I'm talking about. Just do the bare minimum. Like Tanya said, with all of that, worship him. Worship him. There's nothing like it. This past, maybe 3 or 4 months, I found myself just praising the Lord all day, every day. And it's, I don't have to do it out loud, all right? Although I've been caught a couple of times doing it, but I don't care. I don't care. And I praise you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. I just can't help but do that. And it's been just pouring from me, and I thank God for it. I don't want to stop it. That's music to my ears. I'm just very happy that we're in the age of Bluetooth, so that when people see me driving and my mouth moving, right, they don't say, that guy is nuts. They're probably saying, he better get off the phone. Oh, my mouth be moving a mile a minute. All right, I'm coming from Hebrews chapter 6. Verses 13 through 20. Hebrews, not Herbrews. Hebrews chapter 6, 13 through 20. And I'll read. When God made his promise to Abraham, since there was no one greater for him to swear by, he swore by himself, saying, I will surely bless you and give you many descendants. And so, after waiting patiently, Abraham received what was promised. People swear by someone greater than themselves, and the oath confirms what it said and puts an end to all argument. Because God wanted to make the unchanging nature of his purpose very clear to the heirs of what was promised, he confirmed it with an oath. God did this that by two unchangeable things, in that which it is impossible for God to lie, we who have fled to take hold of the hope set before us may be greatly encouraged. We have this hope as an anchor for the soul, firm and secure. It enters the inner sanctuary behind the curtains where our forerunner Jesus has entered on our behalf. He has become a high priest forever in the order of Melchizedek. Now, the dictionary tells us that hope is a yearning with expectation or anticipation. The Greek definition of hope means to be intensely expectant, to be confidently looking forward to something you fully expect to happen. All right? Hope is, or anticipation is the anchor of your soul. This isn't I hope so. This surpasses this greatly. So what should I be hopeful for? Glad you asked. God's ultimate blessing forever and ever with God in eternity, forgiven, accepted, purified, glorified, capable of unspeakable joy, triumphant over all our enemies, sin and guilt and shame and death and hell and Satan. This is God's promise. Isn't that a wonderful thing? The author of Hebrews was writing to people who were facing hardships and persecution because of their Christian faith. Now, I have to say something to folks, all right? And I'm not talking to you folks here, I'm talking to the folks on Facebook. You may be sitting out there and you may be saying, oh, the devil is doing this and the devil is doing that and the devil is doing the other. Really, are you out there witnessing? Are you handing out tracts? Are you praying for the weak and the ill? Are you pressing forward to do God's will? Now, if you're answering no to those questions, then it ain't the devil bothering you. That might be the Holy Spirit giving you a boot. That's a fact. Why should the devil get on you for being lazy? Now, I'm not talking to you folks in here. Why? Why should the devil chastise you for doing nothing? Seems kind of weird saying the devil this, the devil that, the devil the other. Hey, you ain't doing nothing. He bugs and bothers the people who are working for God. So if you ain't working, don't say the devil is doing anything. That's a lie from the pit of hell. But of course, it's not happening. It's not happening. He wants you lazy. He loves you to be lazy. You're one less person he has to be after because you ain't doing nothing. And if you ain't doing nothing, he said, okay, you stay peacefully here. You stay peacefully there. The author of Hebrews was writing to people who were facing hardships and persecution because of their Christian faith. A few were tempted to abandon Christ and return to Judaism. He is urging them to persevere by putting their focus on the superiority of Jesus Christ and the salvation that he has provided. He is trying to instill in them biblical hope, not just a positive, cheerful disposition, but a steady attitude of joy based on the promises of God who cannot lie. Promises of God who cannot lie. Whew. Should have had a cold thing just come up your spine. Ooh. I thought they already did my surgery. I felt that chill going up my spine. All right. He uses a metaphor used only here in the Bible of an anchor. But instead of it going down into the ocean, this anchor goes up into the heavens, beyond the veil where Jesus has entered as a forerunner for us. He has become our high priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek. Now, Bible Gateway says that there are 5,467 divine promises. And I promise I'm not going to do them all tonight. All right? I promise. Now, I believe that each of those promises are like a link. All right? Each one of them is a link that instead of going down with the anchor, it's going upward, right behind the veil. And it is being placed right into Christ, who is sitting at the right hand of the Father, isn't making intercession for us. Isn't that a wonderful thing? But each one of those promises is a link. How many of you have heard of that television show, The Missing Link? Right? Tanya and I watched the show, you know. So it's a game show where you have everybody participating, and they vote a person off each time around, and she says, "You are the missing link. Goodbye." All right, you're the weakest link. Goodbye. And the person will have to leave, all right, until you get down to two people, then they battle it out for the money. Tonight I'm going to do a version of The Missing Link, if you don't mind. And if you do, it doesn't matter. All right. I'm going to give you 10 incredible links that are promises to us, that if we are holding fast to them, you're making the devil afraid. Ooh, yay. Amen. You're scaring him to death. If you ain't scaring the devil to death, then you're just entertaining him. All right. If you're not shaking them up, you're entertaining him. Plain and simple. All right. First promise, God's acceptance. And everybody knows this. Write this address down. John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Now, that's the first step. That's the first awesome step that we walk into. You are a whosoever. All right? Whosoever will is your last name. Okay? So you all are whosoever will. All right? And you find yourself now saved. I like it when people stand up and say, I'm saved, sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost, got my bags packed, I'm heading to heaven. You better unpack them clothes. You got work to do. You got work to do. All right, and you're going to get right funky walking around in the same outfit every day. You can't save anybody like that. They'll be running away from you. So, that's God's acceptance. That's number one. But 1 John 3:8 reads like this. He who sins is of the devil, for the devil has sinned from the beginning. For this purpose, the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. If this type of person describes you, you are the weakest link. Goodbye. Yeah, yeah, Number two. Oh. Oh, I said 1 John 3:8. You got that. All right. And I said, if this describes you, you are the weakest link. Goodbye. Number two, God's protection. James 4:7 reads, submit yourself then to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. You know, I love this particular portion of scripture, but I get tired of hearing people say, oh, resist the devil, he will flee from you. No, he won't. The Bible doesn't say that. The Bible says, submit yourself to God. That's step one. Then you resist the devil, he will flee from you. Don't get it half right. Half right means he's got you. Read the whole thing. Submit yourself to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. But Romans 10:3 reads, for they being ignorant of God's righteousness and seeking to establish their own righteousness have not submitted to the righteousness of God. If this describes you, then you are the weakest link. Goodbye. You do understand that all of God's links of promises are negated by you not holding firm to them. God has all of those promises, and if you're only holding on to four of them, you're in deep trouble. They're all yours. Jump on them. Hold fast to them. Become strong by them. Oh, my goodness. Okay, number three, divine freedom. John 8:36 says, so if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed. John 8:24, therefore I said to you that you will die in your sins. For if you do not believe that I am he, you will die in your sins. If this describes you, then you are the weakest link. Goodbye. You might, I think maybe some of this is starting to sink in. All right? It was funny in the beginning, but then after a while it starts to sink in. I'm talking to you folks out there on Facebook. Number four. Divine provision. Philippians 4:19, and my God will meet all your needs according to the riches of his glory in Christ Jesus. John 8:44, you are of your father, the devil, and the desires of your father you want to do. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth because there is no truth in him. When he speaks a lie. He speaks from his own resources, for he is a liar and the father of it. If this describes you, then you are the weakest link. Goodbye. You'd be surprised at how many saints of God probably are flunking this. Number five, divine peace in times of trouble. Philippians 4:6-7. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your mind through Christ Jesus. Daniel 4:32. Good old Nebuchadnezzar. And they shall drive you from men, and your dwelling shall be with the beasts of the field. They shall make you eat grass like an oxen, and seven times shall pass over you, until you know that the Most High rules in the kingdom of men, and gives it to whomever he chooses. Whew. If this sounds familiar, then you are the weakest link. Goodbye. 6, God's unconditional love. Romans 8:38 and 39. Now, I love this, and I love all these scriptures, because sometimes we claim scriptures without living the life that that scripture can lay on top of. Know what I mean, folk? I'm glad she said that. So here's this scripture saying A, B, C. This is your promise. You say, oh, thank God, praise God. But you don't see what's behind it. You don't see what's behind it. You're not living the life to receive that promise. So all these promises that are out there, you're not living the life that's required to receive them. Salvation is the only thing you receive without doing anything about it, other than accepting Jesus as your Lord and Savior. From that point forward, you have to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. From that point forward, we have all of these beautiful sacred promises in the Bible, but we're not living lives to be able to receive them. That's what I mean. That's what I mean. That's why I'm doing this little exercise right here. I want you to open up your eyes to the fact that you got to live something to get something. All right? You got to live something to get something. The beautiful part about it is that what you're going to receive is absolutely fantastic. Fantastic. This isn't meant to be a downer. This is meant to be a wake-up call. I want you to be able to grab all 10 of these things and run out the door and start saving people up and down the block. I would love to see that. But we all have work to do. All. We all have work to do so that we can stand on. That's what it means by standing on God's promises. You got to know what they are and what kind of life is expected of you in order for that promise to really bear you up. You understand what I'm saying? Good. I thought I was talking to the folks in Facebook for a moment there. And I can't hear back from them. Number 6, God's unconditional love. Romans 8:38 and 39. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels or demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. It's time for water. A cold, please, Esther. Now, when we read that particular portion of Scripture, we're thinking that nothing, there's nothing that's going to separate us from the love of God. Thank you so much, which is in Christ Jesus. But there is something that can separate you from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. Oh, but no, that's not the Scripture. No, there is something. Don't argue with me. I'll read it to you. Isaiah 59:2. But your iniquities have separated you from your God, and your sins have hidden his face from you so that he will not hear. If this describes you, you are the weakest link. Goodbye. Divine strength. Philippians 4:13. I can do all things through him who gives me strength. How many of you love that portion of Scripture? You love that portion of Scripture? Everybody's afraid to raise their hands. I noticed that. This isn't a trick question. This is it. Okay, write it down, but it's not a trick question. You all love that, right? I can do all things, all, capital A-L-L, which means everything. But when you get up, you moan and groan and, oh, Lord, I don't know how this is going to turn. I am so down, I can't take it anymore. Well, how can you love that portion of Scripture and live that way? Something isn't being truthful. Either the Scripture's not being truthful, or you're not being truthful. I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. What? Did he run out of strength-giving ability? You have to be able to get behind the Scripture and live up to it. You have to say, if you're going to stand on that Scripture, it means all things. And it starts with that I. It's not you can do all things, I'll just hang out and watch you. No, it's I can do all things through Christ Jesus who strengthens me. I better not say, oh, I don't know how to do that. I'm whining over what? What? Is there something outside of all? If there is, tell me. I'd like to find it so I can go back to the Bible writers and tell them you missed something. All things. So I submit to you, 1 Corinthians 2:14. But the natural man does not receive the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him, nor can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. If this describes you, you are the weakest link. Goodbye. Now, Samantha, I told you that it was going to be a 50-50 affair tonight. Am I holding up to that? Yep. I'm holding up to that, right? Samantha, when we were in the room praying, said, we're going to have this service this evening, and we're going to be lifting people up. I said, part of it's going to be tearing them down, but the other part is going to be lifting them up, all right? The only thing that I'm tearing down is the fallacy of God doing everything for you without you living anything. That's the fallacy. That's the fallacy. I get up saved and I could do anything I want. Nonsense. No, you cannot. Read your Bible. It will tell you so. All right? It will tell you so. Divine escape. It's number 8, divine escape. 1 Corinthians 10, verse 13. No temptation has overtaken you except what is common to mankind. And God is faithful that he will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, he will also provide a way out so you can endure it. You all believe that? Everybody in this room believe that? Oh, stop it. Come on. Think back to your last trial. You don't have to blurt it out. Think back to your last trial, just for a moment, okay? And after you've thought about that, I'm hoping that this scripture did pop up and that you did fully believe what it said and you move forward by faith. Amen. That's what I truly hope happened. But I know that for the most part, people get, they allow idiotic devil to drag them up and down the stairs when that jerk don't have the power to do that to you. He doesn't. And yes, I called him a jerk. How stupid can you be to think you could take God on after he created your stupid butt? You have to have a hole in your head. How stupid was that? He doesn't get any respect from me for being smart. He's a moron. And we allow that moron to lie to us. And he whispers his lies in your ears and you just can't help but listening to what he's got to say. He's a liar. He's the father of all lies. When he speaks, he's speaking lies because that's his language. Excuse me. So anyway, knowing that God isn't going to give you more than you can handle, when you fully believe that, it's amazing. It's amazing how by faith you can move forward and accomplish not what you want to accomplish, but accomplish what he wants you to accomplish. I want you to know something. Too many people step out there, jump off into something, and then when it messes up, they blame it on the devil, all right? When God didn't send them out there in the first place, God didn't put them out there. He's waiting for your ignorant self to come back to him. And he'll love you back into his womb. Then you'll ignore him again and go off on your own. Oh yeah, the Lord has given me this fiery ministry and I'm going to do this, that, and the other. Really? Is that a fact? Let's see how fast you fizzle out. See, God wants you to understand something. He has promises, but you have to live up to the promises. Amen? Amen. Okay. Just want to make sure we got that in there. Okay. Mark 7, 20 through 22. And he said, what comes out of a man that defiles a man? For from within, out of the heart of man, proceeds evil thoughts, adulteries, fornications, murder, theft, covetousness, wickedness, deceit, lewdness, an evil eye, blasphemy, pride, and foolishness. Did I miss anything? If that describes you, you are the weakest link. Goodbye. Number 9, divine wisdom. James 1:5. If any of you lacks wisdom, you should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to you. Do you think that you're an exception? Is anybody in here an exception? In other words, something's written in the Bible, but it isn't meant for you. No. Nobody here is an exception, right? If any of you lacks wisdom, you should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to you. He's got this whole big box of wisdom sitting there waiting for you to say, can I have some of that? Can I have some of that? Instead, we just go forward and do foolish things. How does that make any sense at all? Not even slightly. I got this big box of wisdom. And it's yours for free. You want some? Now, I'm watching my weight. Oh, my goodness. Proverbs 18:2. A fool has no delight in understanding, but in expressing his own heart. If this describes you, you are the weakest link. Goodbye. And finally, number 10. His divine attention. 1 John 5:14. This is the confidence we have in approaching God, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. Wow. You mean I could ask God for a Rolls Royce? I can ask him for a big palatial home. I can ask him to get rid of so-and-so and so-and-so. Watch out. Watch out. I can ask him to do that. Folks, it says this is the confidence we have in approaching God, that if we ask anything, here's the provision, according to his will. He hears us. When you throw stupid stuff at him, he laughs. He laughs. You're amusing God. All right, get it together. According to his will. Proverbs 18:6-7. A fool's lips enter into contention, and his mouth calls for blows. A fool's mouth is his destruction, and his lips are the snare of his soul. If this describes you, you are the weakest link. Goodbye. So, let's take it back to the top. What is hope? To be intensely expectant, to be confidently looking forward to something you fully expect to happen. If that's the way your heart is about the Word of God, then you're not playing this game of the weakest link. Those links that are going up to heaven are firm and solid. Firm and solid. None of them are weak. So what should I be hopeful for? God's ultimate blessing. Forever and ever with God in eternity. Forgiven, accepted, purified, glorified, capable of unspeakable joy. Triumphant over all our enemies. Sin and guilt and shame and death and hell and Satan. This is God's promise. This is God's anchor. But it starts with you. Don't play games with God's word. Stand firmly on it. It doesn't mean you lay the Bible down on the ground and step on it. Standing firmly on God's word is ingesting its promises and doing accordingly. Then you will receive those blessings. Now, by the way, I want to warn you against something. Don't think that just because you start doing this and then God's blessings start hitting you, that all it's like you hit a jackpot. It's almost like the jackpot hits you. All right? Do you think that Samantha stands on God's word? Let me see the hands of those that think that Samantha stands on God's word. How busted up do you get on a weekly basis, Samantha? Right? You got things hitting you left, right, left, right. You stand nevertheless. By faith you stand. But it doesn't mean that it's going to take away any of the attacks, any of the blows that's going to come upon you. It just means that somebody like Samantha is able to stand on God's word above the storm. So if you want to learn how to walk by faith, the requirement of that is standing on God's word by living up to God's word. Then you've got it made. Let's close with a word of prayer. Our Father and our God, I thank you for your word. I thank you for letting me have a little bit of fun with it, even though this is very, very serious. I pray, Father, that those here and those on Facebook heard the word, understand what it was all about, take it, and when we say hide it in the heart, not so deep that you can't find it yourself, hiding it in the heart means changing your ways. Help them, Father, change their ways. And along with them, help me change my ways. And we'll never fail to give you the praise, glory, and honor, which is due to your name. For it's in Jesus' precious name I pray. Amen and amen. God bless you, folks.